Good morning, one and all. Respected dignitaries and dear friends, in the process of introducing transformation to the IMU, many initiatives have been taken by Honorable Vice Chancellor, and interaction with eminent personalities of maritime field is one among them. Since January 2015, IMU is organizing maritime lecture series. Last month we interacted with Dr. L. R. Chari, and today we have Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi ji to deliver keynote address on maritime transport, trade and global economy. I may call upon Honorable Vice Chancellor Shri K. Ashok Vardhan Shetty to introduce guest of honor to this august gathering and to deliver welcome address.
Good morning, everybody. I have great pleasure in introducing Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi, IAS retired. Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi holds a bachelor's degree in arts from St. Stephen's College, a bachelor's degree in law from the University of Indore, a master's degree in economics from London School of Economics, and a doctorate in international finance from the Simon Fraser University. Dr. Trivedi hails from a very distinguished political family of Madhya Pradesh, which has produced several chief ministers and union ministers. I always felt that he had three career options open to him. Because of his exceedingly good looks, he could have become a hero in Bollywood. Because of his political connections, he could have become a minister, either in the center or the state. But he chose to become, on his own merit, an IAS officer. He got into the Indian Administrative Service in 1977 and was allotted to Madhya Pradesh cadre. He held various posts with distinction. In his farewell party, somebody very jokingly remarked that, true to his name of being Vishwapati, he held posts governing the air, the land and the sea. He was CMD of Air India. He was Secretary of Mines, and he was also Secretary of Shipping. He was truly a Vishwapati. He governed all the three realms of the world. Sri Vishwapati Trivedi assumed charge of Secretary of Ministry of Shipping on 1st July 2013, and he distinguished himself greatly in this post. As a reward for the same, he has been appointed as the chairman of the National Shipping Board, New Delhi. My dear young friends, Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi is a role model for all of you. He is a person who has not only achieved his potential to the full, but he has shown that what a person can achieve, not only even as an IAS officer, the kind of post he has held and the kind of success he has achieved are far above average. It is often customary to ask people, if you are not this, what else would you like to be? And many people say, I would like to be Sachin Tendulkar or Narendra Modi or Shah Rukh Khan or something. If somebody were to ask me, if you are not yourself, what else you would like to be, I would say, I would like to be Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi. The thing about him is, a man of impeccable manners, excellent PR, who is always cool, calm and collected. I often remark to him that even at 7 p.m. in the evening, he is very not hassled, very cool. I mean, the only two other examples that come to my mind are M.S. Dhoni, the Indian cricket captain, and Steve Waugh, the Australian cricket captain, both of whom were unruffled at any point of time. Now, coming to our maritime lecture series, From January 2015 onwards, Indian Maritime University has decided that we must invite every month for the benefit of our senior students, the PG students and the final year and pre-final year students, important personalities from the maritime sector. The interaction with them is very important. It will broaden your mental horizons and possibly, if you invite the right people, improve your placement prospects. Classroom instruction is important, but what you learn beyond classroom instruction is even more important. You need to listen to people like Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi, who bring with them an immense amount of knowledge, and I'm sure you will have a great time listening to him. With these few words, I welcome Dr. Vishwapati Trivedi to the Indian Maritime University, a university to the setting of which he has contributed a great deal, and I welcome all of you. Thank you.
Now, felicitation by Honorable Vice Chancellor.
Honorable Vice Chancellor, Mr. Ashok Shetty, dignitaries on the dais, faculty of IMU, students of IMU, ladies and gentlemen, it's a very difficult task, although I must be speaking as a secretary in the government in hundreds of conferences and seminars, but to focus on a subject and to speak on a subject, especially given my habit of not reading the speech, it becomes very difficult to, but it's always a pleasure because I, as Mr. Shetty says, that if I was not in the IAS, what would I have done? I would have probably chosen to be a professor. And all my life, I was a science student. This is just to give you a perspective on why things happen in the world, how they happen. I was a science student until we used to have class 11 those days as the higher secondary. And my father made me write every competitive exam under the world, under the sky. I wrote the in class 7th or 8th, I wrote the public school entrance scholarship. I qualified for it. But unfortunately, my father, who was in the government service also, his salary was large enough to disqualify me, so I could not get that scholarship. Then I wrote the Sainik school exams. My mother said, no, we don't want him to go to the borders and all that. Again, I qualified, could not get in there. Then later I wrote the National Science Scholarship, National Science Talent Scholarship. That was around class 11th. That's the last year you write. I got into that. But they said, no, you don't have to do pure science in college. So I couldn't take that. I also wrote the IIT that year. And I got into the IIT. And my father said, well, I've been an engineer all my life, and I think it's a very boring profession, so don't get there. Eventually, I applied to the Delhi University for a BA honors in economics at St. Stephen's College, which was today, a student who gets into St. Stephen's College BA Honours has to have 99% and above. And they say sometimes people have to score 105% to get in there, which is so difficult to get in there. Those days, with whatever percentage I had, they gave me an invitation, actually, and without an interview, I was taken in. I continued there ups and downs. Certainly, this was BA honors economics. Now, economics those days was also very math oriented. So there was a lot of mathematics going on there, which came handy for me. And by the end of my BA honors, I got a little more ambitious. I said, well, let me do my postgraduate degree in London School of Economics. So at the London School of Economics, they put a condition that you have to get 60% and above in your BA honors economics. But those days, out of 2,000 students in Delhi University writing in various colleges, only 5 or 6 people used to get above 60%. But that was a huge challenge. So one of my very dear cousins, they were traveling to Balaji in 1970, I remember. And they came back and they said, well, we have wished that you get above 60%, but if you get that, you have to go to Balaji for a tonsure. I said, okay, this is a very big condition you imposed upon a young man who doesn't want his hair shaved off. In any case, the challenge was so high that one had to really work really hard. We forgot about any commitments, any vows, anything. The idea is to get 60% and above. So we got 60% above. Now I was admitted to London School of Economics, where an old friend of mine was there. He said, well, Mr. Trivedi, please come here don't start getting, your mother will want you to stitch clothes in India which last you for 3 years here. Don't do all that. Everything is available. Only thing you should be worried about is your hairstyle. Now, I had I couldn't speak. I said, well, my hairstyle is going to be a full tonsure because I'll first go to Balaji, get my hair tonsured, and then I'll fly to London. And that I did with a bald head. Well, it was welcomed in Western Europe. These things are welcomed. So I didn't realize, and I thought I'd done a great job getting my head tonsured. So Balaji came to my rescue there. Then I realized that they had given me admission into a 3-year BA honors, BSc honors, the BSc economics, which was one of the best courses, like in Cambridge, in Oxford, they have standard. In Cambridge, there's a course called TRIPOS. So it's also a very highly decorated course. So they had, now I said, I can't do a double BA. I've already done a BA honors. How should I do a BSc economics here? So I came in touch with Professor Amartya Sen, who was teaching at the London School of Economics those days. He had also been a professor at the Delhi School of Economics. So I went and I said, sir, you know what goes on in Delhi University, how tough it is, and still you want me to do a BA honors, another BA here. He said, you make an appeal, we'll see what we can do. We'll take it to the Academic Council, let's see what they do. So they took it up to the Academic Council, and Academic Council imposed a condition. That was the first time ever a condition was imposed and a promotion given to an Indian student directly into the master's, but with a 2-year clause. Master's, there is a 1-year course. So they said, we'll give you a 2-year course. First year would be your qualifying. If you were to qualify, then we'll give you a regular one. But if you don't qualify, you go home with no scholarship, nothing, and no degree. I said, okay, a young man of 19 years, we said, well, we were scared of nothing. We'll just do everything. And got there, did my master's. So the system moved in a manner that I got into hardcore economics. And ever since then, I've maintained my touch with economics. I've taught several places in economics wherever I could get time. I worked in places where economics is involved. I've applied economics. And now today, I just want to introduce, since for the last 3-4 years I've been working with the maritime sector, I thought there was a lot of economics in the maritime sector also. But my idea now to speak to you is not purely on economics, but I will talk to you about how the maritime trade is developed. Behind every trade there is economics. In fact, behind every action there is economics. So that is the thrust of what I'm going to be talking to you about. I will briefly, it took me some time to actually design the contents, but once the contents were ready, it was easy to develop the rest of it. So we are on the contents thing. So I'll introduce shortly, these are the contents. I wouldn't take too much time going over all of this. Somebody told me that a slide should never have more than 7 points. So when I was writing the 8th point, I made it really short. I said there has to be some reference to what I'm going to do in the end. So the first point was the introduction to economics behind the trade. I don't know how much of you, economics is taught within as a part of your curriculum, but if you are taught, fine. If you are not taught, even then it's fine. The way I would be telling you would be in a very flowing, historical, easy, graspable manner, but I will bring forth a lot of facts, figures, dates, leading trends in maritime sector from 3000 BC onwards. And I'll take you through a travel of 5000 years in this 150-minute time. So allow me to continue with that. There is a gentleman in 1776 who wrote a book, a very famous chap called Adam Smith. He is the father of all free liberal economics. He wrote several things about how free trade developed, how free economic freedom in doing transactions, no regulation, etc., is the best way to survive in the economy. He wrote lots about how productivity can be increased in the economy. One of the points he wrote was the division of labor. The idea of division of labor, of course, we can say division of labor has been in India since Manu Smriti, they've been talking about division of labor, but that's not what he had in mind. He was talking about division of labor in the manufacturing and such production fields, where he said that there was a very famous example of a pin manufacturing that he gives and which is quoted. So I'm just quoting a very standard example here. Some may have heard of it, some may not have heard of it, but I thought it was a very appropriate example to show how manufacturing can be increased by division of labor. He said all that if there is a pin and if I'm to manufacture the pin, I'll manufacture the wire, I'll make the point, I'll make the head, and I'll just waste all my 2-3 days doing it, and I have to do everything, so maybe I'll produce so many pins in a day or in a week or whatever. But he said if you divide this labor, somebody makes the wire, somebody puts the finer point, somebody puts the head on the pin, so the manufacturing can be increased something like 30-40 folds. So he showed a real example in those days of Industrial Revolution in Britain, that this is what can be done. But when he says this, having said that, what he meant was this is how manufacturing can be increased. But when the maritime guys came in, he said, well, you may increase your production, but it is limited by how much you can sell. You have to produce, you have to sell. In a small country like England, it does not much could be sold, so he said, well, then comes the importance of the shipping industry. Maritime transport importance starts from there. Nations produce goods, but how do they transfer goods? How do they ship goods? That's where the importance of shipping comes in. Not all nations can consume all that they produce. Some nations do, some nations don't. But in those times also, there was need for shipping to capture the real efficiencies of the market. You have to have a larger and larger market. That's one part of the importance of shipping. The other part, I'll quickly go through it. Why does trade take place? I mean, why am I selling to England, or England is selling to USA, or USA is selling to Japan? What? Why is that happening? You must think about it. Well, there was a set of Swedish economists called Hexter and Olin, who actually first came out with a theory, what is called the theory of comparative advantage. You can apply this theory in real life, in your house, in your, this is a very typical theory, that anybody who can produce a good more efficiently should be allowed to produce it more efficiently, and then the trade should be maximized. So if USA can produce cars more effectively and India can produce wheat more efficiently, then they should produce wheat and they should produce car and then they should trade. So that's how the theory of, because India has a comparative advantage in labor, US has a comparative advantage in capital, so they must do the best that they can do in their own countries, and then they exchange and the trade can take place. And that's how and that's why the trade takes place. It is explained by the factor endowments between capital and you might say, well, today India is also producing cars, so who's got the advantage? Well, over the years, this theory of comparative advantage was true in those days, 100 years back. It could be seen more clearly operating in the trading system of the world. But today, it's a much more complicated market, that because of the migration of labor, migration of technology, migration of capital, things are different. But still, if you go behind any trade that takes place, you'll see that the country which exports has a comparative advantage in that product, and the country which imports has a comparative advantage in that product. That said, I would leave it with you. These are the issues of economics, and this is why the trade takes place. So two things I've said. One is the importance of shipping. Manufacturing can be increased, but without shipping, it cannot go anywhere. Number one. Trade will take place if you have comparative advantage. If there is a difference of something between the two countries, only then the trade will take place. And that takes place. Typically now, the trade, the way it takes place, is reflected in the exchange rate. If we are weak in exports, and the Americans are strong in their exports or our imports, then the dollar will become more expensive, rupee will become weak. That's how the exchange rate regulates the trade. And eventually when the export becomes cheaper to the Americans, some of our exports, so then the exchange rate balances. That's why you see that the Indian exchange rate keeps fluctuating up and down. Of course, it's flattened out at around 60 rupees nowadays. This is just a little background to what I could not help not seeing economics before I tell you the global developments. Then we come to the main part of what I'm going to tell you. This is going to be more of a narrative into what happened over the years. And this is for your, as Vice Chancellor Saab said, that this is only to increase your awareness of where what we are doing has a huge historical and a maritime background. That's what my intention was. So I will take you through some earlier parts of, then come to the modern parts, and then show some differences in technology which may be of usefulness to the people who are studying naval technology and other things. There are two parts, very distinct part. Those days also there was a Western Hemisphere, there was an Eastern Hemisphere, and there was a disconnect between them because of the big oceans, Atlantic Ocean, the Pacific Ocean. Each of these hemispheres were growing in their own trading activities, and there was a little bit of a link between the two. I'll just come to some of these. But there are several similarities the way these both the hemispheres and the maritime grew in these hemispheres. Some of the interesting conclusions you will see from there is that wherever in the world it was profit, money, and the lure for more and more money which led the trade. This always remains the underlying reason for trade. But over the years, you can't wantonly allow trade to somebody killing somebody, somebody grabbing somebody. So some system of property rights has to develop. So over the years, as we saw that the kings and the rulers and the emperors dwindled out, democratic nations came up, who could sit on one table. World wars had taken place. People could sit on table and discuss, let's have some rules of doing business in this world. And that's what happened around the Second World War, when all these institutions got together and they said, well, let's have rules for trading, rules for so many things, the United Nations and all that came up during those days. A typical example I just thought I'll briefly touch upon was also that you'll remember that we talk about the gold rush in California. When people knew that there was gold available in California, everybody went there. So this is my piece of land, that is your piece of land. Next morning I will encroach upon your land because I have a bigger set of people to back me up. So there was, then they sat, the rules were made. Same thing happened in the maritime history. In the Western Hemisphere between 3000 BC and I hope you understand the BC concept. The BC concept is before Christ. We used to say before Christ. Of course, now we call it BCE, before Common Era. Now we don't refer to BC as a before Christ. And AD used to be Anno Domini, which is after the Christ. Now we call it Common Era. So it's, sometimes you call it AD is called CE and BC is called BCE. This is just me for. There was trade in the Arabian Gulf. There was trade in the Mediterranean. There was trade in the Eastern Mediterranean. Mediterranean of, I hope you just close your eyes and you see that there's a globe, and I'll show you some maps to put you in perspective. Then there was trade in what is called the Hanseatic League. These are very, very important terms used in maritime history. Hanseatic League was a very interesting thing, that it was a conglomeration of guild cities which were run by traders. You'll be surprised to know that the guild system of those days, and there was a guild system in actually South India, there's been a lot of research which has been done. There was a guild system which was operating, and a very effective guild system in India also. So they were traders who controlled the city, and then the cities transported and transacted between each other, and there were rules of the game between them. They had formal agreements, who will not encroach here, how will the ship come, what will be the wharfage, what would be the other charges, and so on and so forth. So these are the four things we will go through. First, the Arabian Gulf. The trade between the Indus River, Harappa and Mesopotamia had developed those days. Harappa is actually somewhere close to where Pakistan is now. And Mesopotamia, you know, is somewhere where Egypt was. Egypt is. Famous cities like Babylon, who are there in Egypt, were the major centers those days. And I have seen, in fact, that's why I've written here, I've seen some of the old documents. They've been inscribed on stones, which one of them is called the Code of Hammurabi, and which actually fixed everything. It was like almost like a strong regulatory system which works. And there was trade between Mediterranean and our own. In Harappa, in that part of the Indian continent, they've found boats which were used by Kerala teak. They used to make boats with Kerala teak and put them together with jute ropes soaked in fish oil. So those are the kinds of things they used to do, and they've been found. So that's the kind of boats which emerged initially. And of course the trade was between, as I said, with the comparative advantage of Harappa and the comparative advantage of it. Whatever was cheaply grown there was brought here, whatever was cheaply grown was brought there. So that's how the whole thing took place. I'll show you a small map. Next one, please. Now this, I hope it's clear. This is how the whole thing looked like in 2000 BC. You see that there is the Indus River, which is the Indus River civilization, Harappa and all that. And they used to go through the waters and then cross over by camels and things into Babylon and others, and then they used to come all the way to this junction, and then that's where it was again transported to the south and north of Europe from this part of the and you see the Nile River, which is the Egyptian River. This is how the trade, this is what I'm saying, that the trade routes were. You'll see something very interesting here. I don't know if I have a laser thing, but we have some pointer. Please. For example, this is the Mediterranean Sea. And even in 500 BC, they thought that this part can be connected to this part through what is called the Suez Canal. Now, Suez Canal gets its name from a town called Suez here, and it was dug in 500 BC first time. It was, of course, dug like almost something like Buckingham Canal, as small and as narrow, but it was dug by people who thought trade has to go through this. Later on, you will, if you are interested in the history, you should go into the history of Suez Canal and see from 500 BC up till now, up till the 16th or 17th century, how Suez Canal was dug again. Sometimes the rulers closed it. They actually put mud on it. They said, well, we don't want this trade. Again it was dug. And finally, I think it was dug by the French in a more proper manner. And today, it's a very popular, very frequented trade route. Next please. Then there was a class of people called Phoenicians. These are terms I'm leaving with you because I hope you will remember them and read them when you find time. Today it's not so difficult to read. You just plug into this word called Phoenician and you know in the internet what's going on. These guys were people who were on this side of the Mediterranean. And they used to trade. This is where the trade from east came, and this is where most of the trade took place for onward transmission to Europe. I'm talking about BC here. This is all BC. Next please. Later on, I'll quickly run through it. Later on, you must have heard of Alexander, who in something like 332 BC, he actually, there was a war, and he captured all these ports. And then Athens, the Greeks, became the big center. If you just, I'll come later. So the trade is now actually moving from here to this side, the centers of trade. The center of trade was here, then it moved here, now it's actually moving here towards Greece. Soon you'll say it will go towards Rome. Next please. Yeah. At that point Athens became, then the Greeks needed. Now Greeks were a big nation. So they needed to control the routes for their own consumption. And they did that by an Alexander, of course, who came as far as India, and he could capture the whole territory there. Later on, the Greeks were put out of power, next please, and then the Romans came in. So you must have heard of a lot of Roman Augustus, the rulers. So you'll see that the trade from Athens actually moved into Rome. This was the big center those days for trading. Next please. Now, Romans also had a lot of need for bringing stuff to feed their people, so for their own need and for the trading purposes, and since they were Roman emperors and others, so they had taken over the entire route, and I'll tell you the importance of what I'm saying as emperors and as these big rulers took over the trade routes by force, by power, and which is now completely different now in the context that we live today. Later on, now we've come as far as 700 AD, which is we are crossing over from BC to AD here. The Romans had now taken over, and for 200, 300 years, the Romans ruled that area. And of course, there was a lot of Roman trade with India, with all sorts of ports in the southeast and Malaysia, Indonesia, Chinese. There's a lot of history. I'll just briefly touch upon it later. Roman Empire was, you saw there was a track which was land route. Land route was disturbed because the Arab caliphate had by then taken over, and there was a lot of small Arabs fighting between each other, so it was not possible to trade. So they actually now started looking for a good route to the east through the water. Next thing. Venice then later became the big center. Venice is in Austria, in Italy. And these are the what is called the Hanseatic League. There's a term they use for all these towns which were run by merchants. These are cities run by the merchants. There's no government. The government is all the traders. It's like FICCI or CII actually running the town of Chennai. It was that kind of a situation. But they were very aggressive traders and they kept trading. Please, next. We now come to something very interesting. This is when we come to something like 1450 now, closer to where we are now. Sea routes between Europe and Asia developed. Columbus and Vasco da Gama came up. This is when they were looking for all the routes. It's not that trade was not happening before these guys came up, but they were now looking for sea routes. So they were sent. Now there was three big explorers, Diaz, Columbus and Vasco da Gama. Columbus, next please. You may have heard of Columbus, but this is actually explaining the same thing, how the trade has moved. No, please, just a bit. Yeah. Next, yeah, this. Now you'll see that I just compared what Columbus did and Vasco. Now this was the, Columbus was from Venice, Genoa. It was an Italian thing, but it was under the Spanish monarchy. So the Spanish kings used to sponsor these big voyages. Columbus had a big problem explaining to people that the world is round. He always thought, he said, if I start from here, I'll actually reach the east. Whichever direction I go, I'll reach the east. But people never used to believe him. Although in 4th BC, you'll remember that, I don't know if you're familiar with this, I'm sure you are, with what is called the sextant. You know, the sextant is used as a navigational device, and there are mariner charts which actually refer to the sextant. Now the sextant has become highly computerized. You just feed the data and you get your direction. But those days, it was through the, I think something like 57 stars, which were used as navigational stars, and from there you found the direction of where you were going. Columbus had a big problem convincing the king that the world is round, so I should. Finally, he did convince, and finally his trip was sponsored. But he started and he actually landed somewhere here, started from Spain and landed here, which is the Bahamas, you know, the West Indies. That's it, that's why I'm sure you know it's called the Indies. He thought these are Indians. So he actually, Columbus could never, next time he went to South America, somewhere here, and you'll find they call the Red Indians and all that. But Vasco da Gama, he started a few years later, the King of Portugal then said that Spanish guys are doing well. Let me also mount a big voyage. And Vasco da Gama sent something in 1497. He sent this guy, Vasco da Gama, he went round this cape, went to somewhere here in East Africa, and then landed in Calicut. Okay, there, if anyone is interested, you will see that it is such an interesting thing. I've read some chronicles of what happened when Vasco da Gama landed in Calicut. How was he received? Nobody liked the foreigners coming in. They knew these guys will come, take away our trade, and they'll exploit us and sell us their goods and this and that. So the king of Calicut actually put a lot of conditions on him in how he has to stay, how he has to eat, how he has all sorts of conditions. But he got so fed up that he actually went back first time. So he mounted 4 voyages, and at the end of it, he had to fight for this thing, and then he actually grabbed Calicut. They also, Portuguese also landed in Goa, as you know. Goa was a Portuguese territory for a very long time. Next, please. I think I'll just do this one. Quickly, having said that, now we see that the West has come into the East. Asian maritime history is something so exciting, and we think that the Asian, the Chinese have recently come up. It's not true. The Chinese maritime history is so rich that I'm not surprised that Chinese are making the best of the ships, or the kind of production that they do on the maritime front is anything new for them. They've been doing it for 2,000 years. Unfortunately, we were also big maritime ship producers. But somehow, over the years, we have lost that advantage. And if you read the history of maritime India, you see that the biggest of the ships were used by Cholas. But today we have no heritage. We have lost track. We don't even know what they look like. We just have a hull found somewhere, or we'll find a beam somewhere, or a part of a mast somewhere, or some photograph, or some inscription, or something on the rock here, or something in the rock there. But we've actually lost most of our heritage. The highest volume of trade used to take between Chinese, Japanese, Koreans, and Vietnamese in the Far East sector. The Indonesians were very aggressive traders. I'll show you a map and you see exactly how the whole thing gels. The Indian kings, the Cholas, the Mauryas. Mauryas actually, there is a charter we have, I've seen it. There's a charter which was issued those days to actually commission Navy. So Navy was, we say that East India Company made the first Navy to protect their interests, but actually Navy is a very old concept from the Chandragupta Maurya's time in India. Thais and Sri Lankans, they were also very aggressive. You can see that as far back as 4000 BC, they have dug out Chinese boats and paddles, and there used to be, as I said, a lot of trade between the Chinese and the Japanese. The Chinese shipbuilding industry in 2000 BC, and this is actually, I'm not telling you as a story, this is not a story, these are all chronicled by, and somehow there in China too, they found that they developed multi-plank boats, the wooden sailboats, and later, of course, when the steam engine came in after the Industrial Revolution, and then, of course, now they have the best of the biggest of the ships building activity going on in China. Some of the big boats of the Chinese, I think there is a picture I've gotten there, so I'll show that later. The trade links between them. The trade links between the King Solomon of Italy, of Israel, and the Chinese were going all over the world with their big boats, and they used to travel with something like 100 boats together. And I'm talking about, so let's say 1500 years back now, or 1900 years back, in 10th century. Please go, next. The items of exchange were, even peacocks from India. And there is a port called Ophir, which has been referred in the Bible where trade used to take place. And when I started looking for Ophir, they said, well, there's a huge amount of work which has been done on where Ophir is. Eventually, they said, Ophir is actually somewhere close to close to India in the edges of Indus, because they found words like Tukki. I think this is, you call it a peacock, right? Tokai? Is it classic Tamil, or, you know, I tried looking for it, but they say Tokai. They said this is correct, so I said, well, this is correct. And there was a lot of Chinese silk that used to be. Next, please, quickly. Time-wise, we are not too bad. The Mauryas, the Chandragupta Mauryas, they had an army, and it is not, it's all chronicled by in Arthashastra that they had done it. Alexander the Great used to come those days to send ships those days to India. And when the Romans took over, there was a big trade between Romans and Arikamedu, which is probably somewhere close to Puducherry. I have not been to Puducherry, but not been to Arikamedu, but I believe it is, somebody who belongs from Puducherry would know that there's a place. And there was so much of trade in Arikamedu from the Romans that it has gone into reams of writing, all Fahian and the great people who wrote about trade and history of India those days, they have mentioned this place. Next, please. Yeah, this is just explaining how the Arabs and the Roman emperor used to be a conflict between them, but they continued. The Chinese also developed their maritime fleet in the first and the second century, and their vessels actually used to come as far as Kanchipuram. There's a king of, there's a story which I read somewhere saying that the king of Kanchipuram actually presented a rhinoceros to the king of China those days, Sui dynasty or somebody. And they said, where does a rhinoceros come in Kanchipuram? So they said he had been presented by the king of Assam or those days, whatever that region was. So he gave him a rhinoceros, which rhinoceros he gave to the Chinese. There's a very interesting story how that happened. Next, please. As I said, Arikamedu, Pondicherry, there were a lot of foreign merchants, and they were the guilds. They used to call them Yavana. I don't know why, but Yavana is what the word they used. And you will see that during the Roman days, India had a surplus, the Indian ports. Of course, there was nothing like an India then, but the southern kingdoms were so heavily into trade with the Western Europeans that we had a surplus, that they owed us more than we owed them. So then came an emperor, Nero, you may have heard of him, who actually said, well, we will pay you, he debased the currency. Earlier the currency itself was a gold coin. So gold coin means that this is at least the value of the gold. But then he said, well, we'll not use gold, we'll use some paper or something. So the value of gold vanished from there. So Indians lost interest, they stopped trading that much with the Europeans, and a whole lot of trade and the concentration started on the east. Even Sri Lankans, as I said, there was a king of Anuradhapura who used to trade. Next, please. Next. Buddhist monks, it's a very common thing that, you know, Buddhism was born in India, but there's very little of Buddhism in India. It's so much more in Sri Lanka and others. Those are the days when the Buddhist monks used to travel very... and there is a place called Guangzhou, which is, of course, where I think... it's a very famous Chinese port, Chinese industrial town, where there are a lot of old Buddhist temples and made those days. Next, please. Cholas, of course, last year they celebrated the 1000th year of Chola in India. And they were one of our biggest maritime kings who ever lived. That's my conclusion. There may have been somebody else, but I think Rajendra Chola I was probably the biggest maritime explorer as a king. who went and captured areas upon areas in the south, in the east of India, so that he could protect his trade. The idea was to have something like a navy which protects your trade. So I'll show you a picture next. Next, please. This is for your information. You must know these little things, that there is a Strait of Malacca somewhere here. It's on one side is Singapore, the other side is Malaysia. This is where India was, and this is where the entire Chola rulers were. These guys had, they used to send large contingents of 100 ships, and they brought it and captured this. Both sides they captured, so that their trade between the Pacific and the Indian and the Bay of Bengal, Indian Ocean, could take place. That's the kind of great Indian nation we used to have those days. Next, please. There was some, there's a lot of discussion, but I don't think I found in good enough discussion on what kind of ships the Cholas were making. They talk about two types. One is the smaller types, and one are the real big ones. The Kolandia was probably the biggest type of vessels which the Cholas used to use. And there's a lot of mention to the Chola thing, but the design, etc., is not very well discussed in the public, in the public domain. Next, please. So what were the big differences between the Western trade and the East? I don't think, as I said, profit drove everybody. Trade drove everybody. To protect trade was the big idea. All kings protected the trade between their country so that the traders could move. So originally, the traders were themselves warriors. Later, the governments or the kings became protection givers. There were only two big routes, Silk and Spice route, which is from the Asian side, and the Red Sea route through Egypt, which through the Suez Canal and all that. Then, of course, after 1490, when Vasco da Gama came, there was a route through the south of Africa, through the Cape of Good Hope. Next, please. I did some work on how the Chinese ships compared with the European ships. This may be of direct interest to people who are into some kind of marine and naval designing. The Chinese ships were supposed to be very superior even those days. It's not that Chinese are doing well nowadays, but they were doing very, very well those days. They had a ship, I don't know if you understand this term, fore and aft lug skid. Is that a common term used in the... So the Chinese were vessels were fore and aft, which actually ran parallel. I'll show you a picture. But the Europeans had these square type of... They say that these were very slow, but stable. Chinese were both stable and fast. Next, please. This is one of the types of, this is the, now you have these sails coming like this along the beam. So it could take advantage of the wind on both sides. Next, please. Then there's another, there's huge, in history, they've written about a Chinese ship which was made during this guy's, he was the commander, Zhang He or something. And this was the kind of European ships they used to. You can see these are square and these are, you know, these are running along the mast and these were running perpendicular to the beam. Next, please. And the Chinese were, of course, as I said, they used to send large ships in large numbers. They always had this issue about numbers. Even our kings, the Chola kings, who had large fleets and they controlled a large portion of Southeast Asia. Please, next. Well, I come straight to the modern times, when after the World War, Japan had to be built. Japan was the big, fast developing nation. Europeans were tired of war. Americans were tired of war. They all sat down. They came up with things like United Nations and International Maritime Organization, which actually lays down the conventions for how the shipping industry will behave over the in the world. And then, of course, the Koreans and Japanese were, of course, progressing very fast. But Japan was the big place and a big thing, big country, which actually moved very fast those days. And this is talking about post-1950s now. Next, please. Today, as we see, there are three major centers. One is the Europe, North America, and the Asia. It is very evident that the trade takes place between these three big portions. And there is a very interesting derivation some economic historian has drawn, which is actually called the West Line. He says, I'll show you the next, it's not a very good picture, but I'll show it next, please. This is saying that the trade started from here, went west, 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 and actually again came back to west, east. So the whole thing is called the West Line. You start from here. This is the way I've started. Phoenicians, the Greeks, the Romans, the Venice, Hanseatic League, then China, the Dutch, the English, the North Americans, Japanese, Korea, and so on and so forth. So these are four phases. The trade actually started from here, went west, and then went all the way further west and surrounded. So we come back to the same place where now these are the big areas of trading, shipbuilding and all that. As you know, the biggest shipyards are in China, in Korea, in Japan. Next, please. I just want to briefly go, you'll say, well, this is history, how does it matter in the future? It tracks the history of maritime in activity in a nation, from where in India at least we can draw some satisfaction that we were a great maritime nation once upon a time. And I think we can aspire to go there. It's not difficult. We've done it before. We can do it. But that's what Chinese, why you can explain why China is where it is today. It's not because they've done something today. They've always been a very big maritime nation. Koreans, the Japanese, they've always been big in maritime. Next, please. There are three or four points I'll say, as I say, what is the future? This is what we are saying, that how do I look into the future of shipping? Something called the globalization. Now, globalization in shipping, as I say, there was always globalization. Things used to come from Mediterranean to Harappa. Things used to come from Rome to China. Things used to move on from Korea to wherever. And there was always globalization. But that kind of globalization was actually marred by segmentation. There was a Roman Empire, there was the Arab Caliphate, and there was this Sri Vijay kingdom in Indonesia, then the Cholas in India, and Chinese, the Ming Dynasty and others. They all separately controlled areas. It was all segmented. After the World War, when the United Nations was made, order was set in. So now we have a different kind of globalization going on, under which is regulated, which is controlled, and which has rules to abide for. And but of course, shipping will always change as more and more globalization, more and more trade takes place. That's one thing. Next. Logistics, something which should interest you very highly, that logistics is something which is the thing of the future. You'll see, one is that you'll see bigger and bigger ships are coming up. My sense is, you may not agree or some may agree, but my sense is that we have also reached some kind of a peak there with something like 40,000 TEUs and huge ships carrying 400,000 DWT and such things. There is a limit to what we can do. Of course, all of us are not doing this, so a lot of people will catch up to that kind of economies of scale. But logistics in the port sector, where you offload the cargo and then you move it into the hinterland, that logistic in some sense has also peaked in some areas. Some of you may have seen, you can actually check the internet, you don't have to travel nowadays, you can check the way these guys have made a port in Rotterdam. I was amazed that in the APM terminal of Rotterdam, port of Rotterdam, you find it difficult to locate one human being anywhere. It's completely automatic. There's a big cart which has a chargeable battery. The battery charging also, the battery is offloaded mechanically. Another charged battery is put on it. It's a low cart which goes, lifts the container, takes it. There's an automatic gantry train which takes it, puts it in this thing, and everything on the screen. There must be some 50 people behind the screen somewhere half a kilometer away monitoring that. And everything is completely automatic. So the question I asked them, why are you investing so much? Is there so much, there's so much of upfront investment in automation? They say that the yield is enough to make their internal rate of return positive over the years. Over some 15, 20 years, they will recover the cost. So logistics is, now India, we still have to see things like that happening. But somewhere, people have reached the best possible logistics that can happen with the... I've actually been to the port of Singapore again, some 20 young people sitting behind screens and operating the entire terminal. You know, there's not a single human being in the terminal. Next, please. Another thing which is now the big thing is is the role of information technology. Something interesting I thought I'll, maybe it's taught in one of your courses, maybe it is not taught in one of your courses, but I find it very interesting, so I always say this thing to people, younger people when I meet, is what is Baltic Exchange? You must have heard of Baltic Dry Index, BDI. People say Baltic Dry Index is moving up, moving down. It's like a stock market moving up, moving down. But what is this Baltic Dry Index? And Baltic Dry Index is not based in anywhere in the Baltic Sea or something. It is actually based in London. Because they are the guys who in something like 240 years back, they laid the lines underwater to check the arrival of the ships, the departure, the papers, the information moving across this thing. And those cables, all of them used to end up in London. This is how the power of the British Empire controlled the entire trade, and it all landed in London. So any information you needed about any ship moving anywhere in the world, you had to actually go through London. And today, you see there's a small place in London which has become the financial district of London, and they control the entire world. They themselves must be not more than Tamil Nadu, but they control the entire trade in the world. Then came these independent exchanges, and of course a little bit about what Baltic Dry Index in any of your exams, if it comes, so I let me prepare you what Baltic Dry Index means. Next, please. Quickly, it's an index which provides an assessment of the market prices of moving the major raw materials by sea. This is a very standard thing. It's like the Nifty, or it's like the Sensex. This is how BDI is in the maritime sector. while I was writing this, I thought I will also tell you very briefly about mention at least these kinds of vessels. We keep talking about Handymax. What is Handymax? You know, what is a Supramax? What is a Panamax? And why is it called Panamax? It is called Panamax because it was designed to go through the Panama Canal. The highest that could go. It is still controlled. The dimensions of a Panamax vessel are still controlled by the heights of bridges and the turns and the depth that the Panama Canal operates in. Then comes the cape size. Why is the cape size? I used to wonder, what is this cape size? Now, cape size is actually, these are large cargo ships which can actually go around the Cape of Good Hope. They can actually go around the south of Africa. That's why they're called the cape size. And there is things like Suez size and several others. Now you have things like VLCCs and big containers and all that. Somebody asked me, how do you measure the freight for containers? Well, freight of containers and liners is still determined mostly by BDI related indices, but there is a measure called Harpex, which actually gives you internationally the freight rates. So if you sit here and ask, I need to move a container from Canada to Mumbai, how much will it cost? So you say, well, this is about 3,000 miles. So 3,000 miles of this of one container will take you. This is the current spot cost. So you book it at that rate, and then you move on. It's like the Sensex. Next, please. The fourth area, which is extremely important and developing, is the use of fuel. Whenever, I'm sure it's part of your curriculum, whenever you are talking about LDO or the heavy fuel or heavy oil that is used in the ships, I think one of the things which you should always think is, how can you make it better? How can you improve the technology? And there are, I'll just leave a thought with you, there are so many awards and rewards in this, our own country and in the world at large, which award innovation. So what I actually meant to say by stating these four trends in the future, globalization, logistics, information technology and environment, these are the four areas which will impact the entire range of shipping activities in the next 50 years. And that, of course, you have to learn the basics, but you may want to also think in terms of innovation in the same field. We keep doing a lot of innovations, but you may want to document it. You may want to go for a patent. And I'm sure it'll stand you in good stead. I think it's been a long time. So, okay. So I said, well, enough is enough. And thank you guys very much for your patience.